Good afternoon, everybody. Sorry for this little glitch. I'm sure we are going to have a great session today. Okay, so let's start. So as instructed, we are going to discuss cyber criminal investigation and advanced attack vectors. We have been observing a sequence of cyber attacks in last few months, and especially during lockdown, it has increased a lot. And criminals have actually adopted a new ways of penetrating your systems, your devices, your networks. So we need to understand, we need to prepare ourselves against that. Before I start sharing with you some of these attack vectors, let's start with some case studies. And I always like to start with my session with this note. So please bear with me. I would love to change the world, but they won't give me the source code. So I truly believe this entire world is a software program, and we all are software plugins. And whatever we are doing, whatever are our interest and likings or decision-making capabilities, they all are quite much derived through the data that we have been fed during our since our birth. So continuously we are receiving information, data points, and lots of learnings from everywhere. And that data is actually creating our personality. So I believe this, and all these hackers, those are targeting you. They actually use this data. They use this data against you to penetrate to your systems, to exploit you. And how do they use it? To understand that, I would like to show you something first, and then we can understand these attack vectors easily. So we all know that all these applications and platforms, social media platforms, and everyone, they are collecting lots of data from us every moment, every second. And what kind of data are they collecting? Why are they collecting? How do they use this data? What all they can do with this data? To showcase this, I would like to show you something from Google and then probably Facebook. And then we will appreciate these case studies which I'm going to share with you. So I'm going to share with you my browser now, and hope you can see my browser. Can you, Vithin, can you confirm?
Yes, very much, Amit. We can very much see your screen. Your browser is very much, yeah.
So I'm just typing google.com/dashboard, and it is uploading the data that Google captures every moment from our devices, laptop, browsers. There's a huge data. Okay, it knows how many Gmails do I have, what is there in those emails, maps, web and app activities, how many mobiles I have used till now, what were their IMEI numbers, when I start using it, when I stop using that, my drive, my all the files and drives and everything. Now I'll show you something interesting. I'm jumping directly to timeline. And this timeline has my last 12 to 15 years of locations. So since when I've been using these smartphones, they are capturing, especially the Google, they are capturing my locations. So you can see all my locations on the map, different countries, different places, and in India. And these are not discrete locations, these are continuous locations. So they are capturing our location almost every second. So to prove that, I'll take you to a date, maybe last year sometime. And this is 2019, May. And then maybe 17th May. I've selected a date, and then right side, you can see the clear map of my movement on that date, which is like every second of my location. So I'm in Copenhagen. I'm staying in a hotel called Cabin City. I started 10:30 in the morning. I took a drive for 19 minutes, which is 5.9 kilometer precisely. Now when I'm clicking on that, you can see the blue line, which is the actual drive, movement of my in my vehicle links. So you can see in Copenhagen what all paths I have taken when I have reached from Cabin City to Embassy of India. So I reached Embassy of India, and then I met with the ambassador, Mr. Gupte. I took a few photographs, and these photographs are mapped with my timeline. Now I have not asked Google to map these with my timeline. It is happening automatically. Then from 10:49 to 1:31, I was there. Then I again took a drive for 19 minutes and reached to a hotel, which is a restaurant. And then I had my lunch and then went back to my hotel. And then I reached to airport, came back. So all these locations are exactly with every mapped with time and the my activities. Now this is something which is happening for every day. If suppose I want to see this year some location 2020. So since last 3-4 months almost all of us are locked. Let me show you Holi. What I was doing on Holi. So Holi was on 10th of March. I just chose 10th of March. You can see I'm in, this is my address. And I took few photographs. So there are more than 161 plus 59 photographs which I captured on that day, playing with colors and all. And all these are mapped. So whatever I'm doing, it has been captured by Google precisely. And this is just location. Let me show you some more data and then I'll take you to those case studies. So the next interesting data point is web and app activity. So Google is capturing what all I'm doing in my browser. Whatever I have searched, whatever I have browsed, the websites and all. YouTube history, whatever I have watched, how long I've been watching that video, whether I liked it or not. I have watched it repetitively. I have searched some keywords and all. There is one more interesting activity, which is called My Activity. Now this is much more dangerous because it shows even a click on your device here. So if I have opened my Gmail, Facebook or WhatsApp, you can clearly see like I've opened that in detail. Facebook how many times? WhatsApp how many times? 3 times WhatsApp since 9:52. Then I started the Microsoft Team meeting and blah, blah, news and all many things. So every second, whatever I'm doing on my mobile phone is capturing, is recording. And these data points are really useful in investigation. Not only we can catch the criminals, not only we can identify the criminals, not only we can verify the criminals, but we can also protect you guys. Sometimes we face complaints where people are wrongly framed against some charges. And they don't have any evidence to convince officers like they did not do that. All these evidences are going against them. At that time, these data points we refer to actually identify what exactly this guy was doing on that day and whether he has actually done something like this or not. So these are some interesting data points which I think we should know. Similar data points Facebook captures, and they capture much more data points. For Facebook, our personal profiling is much more important because Google is doing profiling us in a different way. Facebook is profiling us in a different way. And there are 150 odd applications on an average in our mobile phone. And they all are profiling us. They all are capturing lots of data from us. And this data is in GBs and sometimes in like multi GBs. And this is something interesting now. Because as I say, like most of these companies, those are offering you all these application services, whether it is WhatsApp, whether it is Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, TikTok, or anybody else. They all are offering you this service free of cost. They don't charge anything from you. And they are the richest companies in the world. These are the richest companies. So if you see the valuation of WhatsApp, or if you see the valuation of Facebook or Google or any such company, Google every week, every month, they launch a new product, new service, and it is free. So that is something interesting because they are relying more on your data points, profiling you, and then at the back end, that they are using these data points to target you, to offer you many more things that we know, or sometimes manipulate you in a different way. So this is makes it scary actually. Now let me take you back to my presentation and let's understand how do I use these data points to investigate a case. I'm just resharing my presentation. Somebody asked me, please tell about fraud online shopping sites. How do we protect sensitive information handled and stored by third-party vendors? Okay, interesting questions. We'll discuss this. We'll take some questions. But let me tell you one story first, and then probably we can take these questions quickly. I'll not take much time. Just one story. So these are some interesting case studies. I hope you can see my presentation. These are some interesting case studies which I have solved recently. And you can pick one. And if you don't have much time to wait for your decision, probably I can choose one. Somebody is writing three and, okay, so I'll choose one and which could be the most interesting for you all, which is very recent. Okay, can you see the screen? This is a letter bomb investigation. Very interesting. So I did not reveal these names and locations of this case, but you can understand, you can relate it very well. So I got a call from a renowned politician, and who could be a minister or at some high position. And he asked me, he wanted my help. And he said that somebody has actually released a letter against him, citing some corruption charges. And there are 20 plus corruption charges, and this letter is getting viral on various social media sites, on Facebook, on WhatsApp and other places. So he wanted my help, like, because he was sure, like, all these corruption charges are wrong and these are falsely implicated. So can I find the source of that letter, from where this has been leaked, and who did this? Who is there behind this entire conspiracy? So if you get any such case, how will you start your investigation? I was in Denmark at that time, it was last year's investigation. So I did not have much access to these real informations. So I relied on Facebook. I thought, okay, let's investigate on Facebook and find the real culprit. So the very first thing I did, I just thought, so there are a few assumptions that you need to take first before you start an investigation. I just thought, like, whoever has done this, he's either jealous or he wants to do this conspiracy against him because he's going to take the benefit of this. So I'm assuming, like, this person could be from his own party. So I just searched various posts about this minister, about this person on Facebook, and I found there are many people writing against him, many people. And this is not since last two, three days, but this has been happening since almost a month. So since almost a month, people are writing against him, claiming the various things on various charges. And like, there are many reasons because of that they are actually writing against this person. And surprisingly, I found, like, most of these persons, those are writing against this minister, belong to the same party, from his own party. Now that was interesting. So I picked all these profiles and I collected almost 527 profiles based on the sentiment data analysis. Like, these are the guys, they belong to the same party of this person and they are writing against him. Very good. Now, second assumption, whenever any conspiracy starts, it starts from a location. You cannot have random people from different parts of the world and then asking them to join us for a conspiracy. It doesn't work like this. You always sit at one place. You collect some trustworthy people. Those are, like, highly trustworthy. Discuss with them and then you start a conspiracy. So I wanted to know the location from where this all has started. So I found, like, okay, how many of these 527 profiles belong to the same location? Like, what are their locations? So I found almost 145 profiles belong to same location, constituency, which is Dharampur or something. Again, this name is not true. I had to change it deliberately. So 145 profiles out of these 527 belongs to the same location. Now, the next thing I analyzed, like, how many of these 145 profiles have large set of followers? Or they have more than, like, 5,000 friends or pages which has lakhs of followers. So I picked all these profiles because I wanted to know the leaders. Who are the leaders among these 145 profiles? The rest all are the followers. Normally followers do not do these conspiracies, leaders do. So I wanted to reach to that leader. So I found 17 profiles. Those are, like, having large followers out of these 145, and they have more than 5,000, like, friends on Facebook, and they are influential. Now, out of these 17 profiles, I wanted to know how many of them have actually held any position in party or was minister earlier, like holding some position in government, or like, he should be that much influential that he can actually do such kind of move. And I found three profiles. So out of these 17, there were three profiles. Those were holding some positions in the party or had some government positions earlier. I shared all these three names with the concerned politician, minister, and I requested him, boss, out of these three, somebody would have done this. And then he did some investigation, and then he found, he filed an FIR and released an arrest warrant against them. When they arrested one person out of them who was the most, they were suspecting him the most, they found like his mobile phone or laptop, they all were formatted. He reinstalled all these applications again. So it was recently formatted. There was not much data to investigate. So they were on back foot now. Like, how can we find the evidence against this person? Though we know, like, this, he would have done this. Then they called me again, and I said, sir, because we have, ye humne andhere mein teer chalaya, but it sahi laga, because this person has formatted his mobile phone and laptop, this means that he had something to hide. So for sure, like, this is, he is a culprit, but now we can actually recover that deleted data, and we can definitely find some evidence. Then I came back, we tried to recover some data, we recovered some data, but that was not sufficient enough to prove, like, yes, this person has broadcasted these details, because anybody could have this data in their mobile phone or laptop, but that doesn't prove, like, he has started. So to prove that he has started this, I had to start another level of investigation. Would you like to listen to that another level of investigation? Because I have to check how much time do I have. Okay, I have just 7 more minutes. Okay, yes. So let's take, I'll just quickly summarize, like, it is though very interesting way of finding the culprits. What did I do? I assume, like, somebody has informed this person just before arrest that you are going to be arrested. And whoever has informed this person about this, he should be from police or some law enforcement department. So how to know, like, who has informed him? And assuming, like, nowadays, most of us, when we communicate with each other and want to share something serious and sensitive, we use WhatsApp. So I assume, like, somebody would have made a WhatsApp call to him. But then WhatsApp is reformatted. WhatsApp is uninstalled and reinstalled on his phone. So we didn't have any data to check. So I checked the CDR, call data record analysis. When I checked this call data record, I found an SMS record. So normally when we format the phone and reinstall the WhatsApp, we again get the OTP. And this new OTP is registered in our CDR. It is available in our CDR. So we can format the phone. We can delete all these SMS records from our phone, but it is available on call data record. So I found exactly, okay, at what time this WhatsApp message, OTP message has come. And I found it came at 1:56 or something, and we arrested this person at 2:40 or something. So it was sure, like, at this time, somebody had informed him. That message was a good clue. Then I took one more step, like, assuming, okay, so that was for sure, like, somebody had informed him at one, like, before 1:15 in the afternoon, that you are going to be arrested, so please format your devices and everything. So that he did this well before, and his everything was clean. Now I wanted to know who called him at this time before 1:50. Now, of course, this data was not there in his phone, but this data was there in caller's phone. Whoever had called, and how to reach to that caller. So what did I do? The very next thing, it is very interesting. I just analyzed his WhatsApp groups, people those are communicating with him frequently, and the CDR, that who frequently calls him, who talks to him frequently. And eventually I found 11 and 12 people those are continuously in touch with him. And I requested officers, like, can I get these 12 people's mobile phone instantly? So that I'm assuming, like, some one of them have called him at that time, and these details should be there in their WhatsApp dialing details. And this worked. When we got those phones, we found one such phone of his driver. He called him at like 10 minutes before this OTP message or something. And then we investigated the driver's mobile phone. Then I found one phone from a police officer who informed this driver about this arrest. So this is the way we investigate a blind case. It had no clue, nothing. And then we had to reach to the real conspirators and people those are behind it. I hope you would have learned about the value of this data that we get through Facebook, Google, and other such platforms as an investigator to solve these cases. And there are many such cases which we solve every day. We have a hell of such information to share with you. But because of the time restrictions, I'll stop here. I'll take a few questions quickly. And that's enough. I think for today, though, my PPT had a few learnings as well. But let's stop here. Just to make you, I think somebody asked how to make yourself secure. Maybe I can give you some tips that if you receive, because most of these attacks happens through phishing, and we can spoof email, mobile phone numbers, and also IP addresses sometimes. So that's why it is risky to believe and trust about these, like whatever information is coming through these different channels. And that's why one such suggestion I can give here, that you can verify most of these URLs that you receive on SMS and WhatsApp or email through urlscan.io or virustotal.com. Please refer these two links. Verify any such file which you feel suspected, like it has some virus or something. You can always check it here. You can upload on virustotal.com and it will be analyzed through a sandboxing mechanism, and it will give you the analysis report, like it is a virus, maybe spyware, Trojan, whatever. And then only you should proceed with that file. Similarly, if you receive any link, please verify it virustotal.com or urlscan.com. These are two strong recommendations from my side. Please practice it. And from app side, I will suggest to check your phone through Exodus Privacy. And there is one more interesting application, HackUNA. These two are my recommendations. You can also scan your phone through Lookout application. I personally use it. Very good applications to make sure like you don't have anything malicious in your phone. So thank you so much. I think I'll just see if somebody, some questions are there. And
so Amit, we have a lot of questions. I can completely understand you have a lot of stories, rather not the stories, the cases that you have taken and solved to talk, but due to time constraints, we can take quick questions. I can see one question on the screen. So somebody is asking, Rajkumar, how you are controlling fake requests or attacks? Which techniques or algorithm do you use?
Can you please repeat the question?
I repeat, Amit. So he's asking how you are controlling fake requests or attacks on various portals that you have discussed about, some Facebook or WhatsApp. Which technique or algorithm do you use? This is what he's asking.
Okay, so there are different fake requests or attacks.
Attacks, which is happening, yeah.
Both are different things actually. Fake request is a little social media specific and which has to be verified manually. And attacks are mostly on our networks and systems. And that is something which, so in either of these cases, there are different tools that we use, and right now there are lots of AI tools available, which they check the pattern and behavior of these attacks, and then they analyze it, and then they give you alert in time. Like, okay, this looks malicious. And there are many such techniques. These are used in the background. And a very age-old technique is a signature matching technique, which like getting the hash values of all these payloads and matching it with the database we have. Large set of IOCs available, and we match these payloads with them. Second is training our engine, the AI engine, with these attack vectors, and then making it intelligent enough to sense any such abnormality well in advance and to alert that network administrator. So these are the techniques that we are using right now. Yeah. Any other question quickly?
Okay. Quick question. We can take quick question because already we are running bit, you know, ahead from time. So, sir, can we, so how do we, one is asking S. Nippon, I believe. So how, S. Nippon is the name of the individual. Sir, how do we get to know if a device is being hacked? Very simple question, but yes, he's...
Okay, good question. So, okay, what was the name?
Nippon.
Thank you, Nippon. First of all, you can be hacked without getting hacked your device. So there are phishing attempts as well, where we don't compromise your device, but then we can still steal information from you. And that is something much more dangerous because most of these attacks are happening through phishing. And you would have seen like the people, those are losing their money and all every time Paytm KYC or these kind of frauds. They don't use any very high-tech advanced attack vectors to compromise your device. They simply ask you to install Quick Support app or TeamViewer app or any desk app, and they share your screen and then they see your OTP. So these are the psychological, I would say, like more human vulnerability those are exploited, not the technical vulnerabilities. Even if somebody has hacked your device with some malicious payload, you can always check it with these applications which I have just referred. Lookout is good application. You can scan your phone for Lookout. Lookout will also tell you if your email is compromised anytime before this. Like, because Lookout verifies your email ID with the leaked database of emails on dark web, and then they alert you like this email is available in dark web, and so you should change your password because this would have been compromised long back. So that is something which you can do. Lookout, Exodus Privacy, Hakuna. There are many such interesting applications. I have recommended few, but there are many.
Which can yes, thank you so much, Amit, for this wonderful session. It's always a pleasure to hear from the experts like you. So wonderful session. Thank you so much. And